The Vampire Counts, March 4th.
Hello and welcome to another Total War Warhammer guide. Today we are looking at the Vampire Lord and the Vampire. The differences between them and also the differences between them and the Necromancers. Because at first glance you sort of see, well, they both sort of cast magic. Normally in most armies they've got a wizard and a fighty guy. That's kind of it. But these actually do a bit of both. So I like the way that they've made the Vampire Lord a man and the Vampire a woman. It's just a nice differentiation rather than just having a little bit different colour armour or something like that. They both look pretty spectacular, though. I wouldn't date her. Maybe if she put on some blusher, a bit more blusher, a bit of foundation, maybe. I'll go for it. You know, any port in a storm and all that. Right. Weird tangent already. Right, first thing we're going to look at is the differences between the two. So, the vampires as a whole are much better fighters than the necromancer counterparts. The biggest single difference between them, they've got slightly more hit points. They've got slightly better attack and they do a little bit more damage, but they have much higher armor. They have 90 armor as opposed to the necromancers, which, if memory serves, it's like 15, 20, maybe even 30, but nowhere near as much. But they also can cast spells, and the vampire is a decent melee combatant. Despite being primarily a missile unit or spellcaster, it can hold its own. And then the vampire lord, the biggest difference is that they're a melee expert, so that they love a bit of chopping and slicing. I love his shield, by the way. It looks like something out of the Black Gates. Right, so let's look at their abilities. As we can see, so just quickly, briefly going back to the attributes. So vampire lord is basically a slight upgrade on everything. He carries a shield, meaning that he can stop a bit more missile infantry from hitting him or missiles to hit him. Same amount of armor. He has 20 better leadership, which is quite a big chunk, and the rest is kind of small upgrades. Does a bit more damage, a bit more defensive. The charge bonus is better on the vampire by 5, but not a great deal of difference. So let's have a look at the abilities without scrolling all the way around. So missile resistance 15%, as all single infantry gets. Causes fear, because look at her, she's scary. As with all leaders, encourages booster leadership. They can hide in the forest. They're undead. You know, it's not just pale. It's not just lack of sun. They are actually undead, meaning that they do suffer from crumbling when they're, instead of like running away when they get scared or when they're losing a fight, they will just start to crumble and cause more damage to themselves over time. That's the same with all undead units and heroes. So their first augment is a passive that lasts continuously, and it's everything within 30 meters of the character has +4 leadership, which is fantastic to stop that crumbling. Very nice indeed. They also have an augment on themselves, which is another passive, which is it replenishes the hit points of combatants. So you want this character with your army. We'll go through how you use the characters a little bit more in detail shortly, once we've been through, but that's another good passive spell. So next we've got Life Leeching, which is another passive spell. It's map wide and it greatly increased the power reserves and improved power recharge rate, basically meaning you can cast more spells, which is always a good thing, especially when we're talking about the vampire counts. Disintegrating is the advanced version of crumbling, when you're absolutely getting sloshed in combat, that don't even make any sense. Destroyed in combat, you're going to cause severe damage to yourself and lose hit points fast. You've always got to be keeping an eye on that to make sure you keep the leadership up, make sure you're winning those fights. So, first proper spell is the Purple Sun of Xeris. We've talked about this before, a number of characters have it. So it's a vortex spell, 150 meter range, cast on the ground, and it's really good for damaging multiple units, large units, big blocks of infantry, but it also is useful for disrupting the enemy formation, so you can cast it on a flank as the units are about to collide, and it can, because they're going to have to avoid it, you wouldn't walk into it. And also when you cast it, it lasts for 13 seconds, but it moves randomly, so don't cast it too close to yourself. Next up, we've got a spell that casts on an ally unit, and it gives them the aspect of the Dread Knight, which is a bonus to leadership, which is always nice, but it means the unit can cause terror, which is fantastic for breaking out of their enemy units and doing more damage. Then we've got the Doom and Darkness, which is a hex spell, which is a cast on an enemy within 200 meters. It's got a duration of 29 seconds, which is fantastic, and it gives them -16 leadership. So if you just need to edge the fight in your favor, make sure that unit wins, you can boost them, break a unit quicker, especially it's really good against like heavy Really good morale units, like the sort of elite units, if you need to turn the tide. Like Doom and Darkness, minus 16 leadership, get a charge in the rear, and you're going to pretty much break any sort of unit, even high leadership ones. Next up, we've got Soul Blight, which is another hex, and it's an instant cast, happens immediately. You can cast it on the ground or an enemy, and it's got a 200 meter range, and it affects all units within 30 meters. And it's a basic sort of debuff to everything, so leadership, armor, missile damage, and weapon damage, which is really good if you're about to clash the two big armies were about to clash. Cast that in the middle of them and you'll do some excellent damage. And also, if the enemy's got a lot of missile units, you can cast this further range just to soften up the damage that you're taking from those missile units. Next, we've got Spirit Leech, which is your sort of direct damage spell. So it's a shorter range of 100 meters, but it's really good against enemy heroes and legendary heroes and characters, and even sort of small elite units it's really good against, and does a decent amount of damage. Next up, we've got the Fate of Boona, which is a direct damage spell cast on an enemy unit within 100 meters, and it's another good spell for sort of hitting those big large units, the big front line of the enemy. It's really good, very very nice indeed. So the main difference, so with, I'll talk about that in a sec. So the last thing is Immortal Will, which casts on yourself, and it just means you replenish your hit points faster, or at all. You just replenish your hit points. The main difference between the magic of the vampires and the magic of the necromancers is the necromancers have less sort of damagey spells, and they have more sort of support utility spells. Like, they have multiple spells that replenish hit points, but also raise the dead, and they have the zombies that they can unit that they can make appear. So they're much more utility. These guys are better for in your army fighting and alongside your army and doing some serious damage. So the only difference between there's many differences between the two. It has the Vampire Lord has a different deck. So we go through the missile resistance, we causes fear, encourage, we've done before, hide. It's an undead, same as the other one, crumbling. Yep. They've got the Curse of the Undeath, which is an augment spell cast on himself. It's a constant, so all the time. It's only disabled, like all passives, if you're broken. So it greatly replenishes hit point of combatants, resurrects dead combatants, and heals the injured before it resurrects. Okay, there is comments on multiple forums and Reddits about how well these sort of spells actually work in game. Some people have done some testings and see that actually it doesn't seem to resurrects dead combatants, especially not all the time. It's a little bit hit and miss, this spell, so don't rely on it all the time. That let me know in the comments your experiences with it, because people have done testing and they're not quite sure. So the Vampire Lord himself has more spells that he's able to use, to much like the Necromancer, to help his allies and bolster the lines. Next up, he's got the Hunger, which is cast on himself. It's the constant again, like the other one, replenishes hit points. Then he's got Disintegrating, which is the advanced version of Crumbling. He's got the Curse of Years, which is really good. It's quite an interesting one, this one, because it's a hex that you can cast on the ground or an enemy unit, 200 meter range, and it affects 30 meters around the target you picked. And it reduces melee attack by quite a chunk. Speed, which is really good. If you want to stop a unit trying to escape and you want to charge them down with your knights, that's really good. But also plus 15 ability recharge, so it's really good on heroes and stuff like that to stop them casting as many spells, etc. So that's a nice spell. He's also got the Gaze of Nagash, which is a magic missile, 250 meter range. So that's nice and decent, and it's good against. It's 250 meter range, but it's good against a single target. But it's not very good at range. Ironically, you want the closer the better, and it is dangerous. I've slaughtered many zombies by casting this too near to my own units. It's a bit of almost like a breath weapon type of thing. So it will do damage to your own units, and it's better used at close range. I wouldn't use it at max range at all. There's much better spells you can use. So then you've got the Invocation of Nahek, which is an augment spell cast on an ally unit, and it resurrects the dead, replenishes hit points, and it heals before it replenishes, like all those spells. Then we've got the Raise the Dead spell, which spawns a unit of zombies. This is really helpful just if you need a unit as a bodyguard, or you want an extra unit that maybe could pop up, charge around the back, you know, if you imagine two blocks of infantry hitting each other, you know, the big main battle going on, if you can sneak your Vampire Lord, it's a very short range of the spell, only 60 meters, but if you can sneak round the back, then raise a unit of zombies, and then just charge them straight into the rear with your Lord, that's going to do a crap ton of damage. Then we've got Van Hal's Dance Macabre, which is a augment spell that lasts 16 seconds, cast on an ally, and it's plus speed and plus melee attacks. So really good for, I would say, Black Knight is a fantastic use, because a knight's already quick, but with that speed, they can pretty much chase down anything, and obviously gives them a boost to attack. Then you've got the Wind of Death, which is a vortex spell, lasts slightly longer than other vortex, only 8 meters, 150 meter range, you cast on the ground, you can't cast it on a particular unit, and this is another really good way of damaging large blocks of units, does a crap ton of damage. It's especially good if you're just before you get into the fight, you whittle down the enemy, soften them up for your charge. Then we've got the Foe Seeker, which is only affects himself, lasts 12 seconds, gives him a charge bonus, a speed bonus, and a vigor bonus. It's a nice buff, but I think other spells that help out other units or all the units or buff multiple units are much better than just something on himself, because he's already good in combat, you know, push, but I think there's better uses of your power reserves. Next up, we've got the Red Fury, which casts on an ally. It's only got a very small range for these sort of spells. It's 100 meters, and it gives that unit armor-piercing damage, so fantastic if they're fighting armor, a charge bonus, and plus vigor. The last spell that he has is Undeath Resurgent, and it lasts for 11 seconds, and you cast on yourself, but it affects all units within 40 meters, and it's melee defense, melee attack, and plus 16 leadership. This is my favourite spell that he's got, and the reason it doesn't cost any power, and the reason I love it so much is because I want my Vampire Lord right in the thick of things, fighting out alongside all the big units in the middle of this battle, hit that, and suddenly you've got those crap zombies and skeletons that suddenly become half decent at fighting. So let's have a quick little battle and mess about against the a couple of poor Bretonian units that are over there, because I can see them being buffed. Hello, there you are. So as I said, so there's quite a bit difference. Normally a vampire, like the upgraded version, is only just a slight better version, but the actual Vampire Lord plays a lot differently. So the Vampire Lord is much fightier, but he can also cast the spells. That's the difference between him and a necromancer. Necromancers can't fight, but he can fight and still cast those support spells. The vampire, on the other hand, is just less about sort of supporting her own units, but more about just sort of artillery. Think of her as artillery if you're new to the game and you're sort of not sure about magic. Just use the big spells. We're not gonna have a sort of full-on fight here. We're just gonna mess about with a couple of spells. What should we go for first? I do love me vortex spells. Decisions. Like in a game, pause it, and work out what spell you want to do, because it's not the ideal thing. Just sort of thinking for 20 minutes. Oh, what shall I cast? Come on, girl and boy. All right, let's get him a bit closer. Right, so you're going to go first, and you're going to cast a Purple Sun, I think. It is one of my most favourite spells, because it has multiple uses, as well as doing damage. Too late, already cast it. As well as doing damage, it just disrupts the enemy line, which is fantastic. There we go, suck them in. As you can see, it's fantastic. So you need to prejudge where you're going to cast a lot of these spells, because the enemy can see it. Oh, hello. That must have stung a little bit. He's going for it. He doesn't care. All right, go on then. Just charge in. So I'd use him as a frontline fighty character. Not on his own, obviously, like this. This is crazy talk. And I'd use her slightly different, just being a little bit more careful. So we're going to cast her Immortal Will for no apparent reason. So he's taking a bit of damage here. So we're going to cast our... Obviously, these spells don't cost any mana, so you can sort of use them all any of the time. So let's do that to boost them both. And we'll do... Forget it. So we've already broken a unit. So as you see, if you go and look at my Necromancer video where we were fighting the exact same units, you know, we were getting, they were getting slaughtered by these basic spearmen at arms. So these guys are just kicking ass, taking names. So there you go, there's my little mini guide. Hope you enjoyed it. It's just a sort of rough guide. It's nothing too spectacular. It just helps you if you're new to the game, just learn a bit more about the characters and their different uses. I will be going into more advanced stuff. Check out the various different playlists, because I'm doing one for each army, all the different units. I hope you enjoyed it, and subscribe if you're new to the channel. Like the video if you enjoyed it, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye bye.